Yes, it's me. Haven't you finished ironing?
Not yet.
You'll have your irons red hot?
Yes. I shall have to stand them to cool.
And you don't know what's become of Charlie?
Well, he's not come home from work yet. I supposed he was at the new inn. Why?
That young electrician come knocking, asking if I knew where he was. Hey, a set of nuts had eyes on him for over a week. Nor his wife, neither. But they've got to pass the garden gate every time they go out. I know not on him. I asked him what was the matter, and he said Mrs. Holroyd was anxious because he'd not come home. So I thought I'd better come and see. Was there anything up?
No more than I've told you.
It's a rum one. If he's neither in the new inn nor the Prince of Wales, it's somewhat you've done must have set him off.
It's nothing I've done.
If he goes off and leaves you, whatever shall we do? Whatever have you been doing?
He brought a couple of bright daisies here last night. Two of those trollops from Nottingham, and I said I'd not have it.
You've never been able to agree.
We agreed well enough, except when he drank like a fish and came home rolling.
Well, what do you expect of a man stuck down the pit all day? He must have a bit of relaxation.
You can have it different from that, then. At any rate, I'm sick of it.
You've a stiff neck, but it'll be bowed by you my age.
They tell me, Missus, as your mester's not home yet.
No. Who is it?
Well, ask him to step inside. Don't stand there letting fog in.
Good evening.
Oh, it's you, Mr. Wrigley. He brought his along with Charlie.
Oh.
And ain't you seen out on him?
No. Was he all right at work?
Well, he were note to mention. A bit short-like. Ain't no much to say. I can't make out what he's done with his sin.
Did he come up in the same bundle we all?
No, he didn't. As I was coming out at the stall, I shouted, "I'm coming, Charlie, we're all off." And he said, "I'm coming in a minute." He was just finishing off a stint, like, and he wanted to get it set. He'd been a bit roughish in his temper, like, so I thought he didn't want to walk to the bottom with us.
Yeah, whatever can he have done to his son?
Nay, missus, you mun ax me that. He's none done note as I know on. Only I were thinking as summat had happened to him, like, seeing as nobody had any noise of him coming up.
What is the matter, Mr. Wrigley? Tell us it out.
I cannot do that, missus. It seems as if he never come up pit, as far as we can make out. Happened a bit of stuff fell and pinned him.
And you left him lying down there in the pit, poor thing?
I couldn't say for certain where he is.
Oh, it's very likely not very bad, Mother. Don't let us run to meet trouble.
We're to hope for the best, missus. All on us.
They'll bring him up, I know they will. Smashed and broke. And one of my sons, they burned down the pit till the flesh dropped off him. And one they shot so that his shoulder was all of a mush. Then they brought him home. And now there's this.
Oh, don't, Mother. You don't know that he's hurt.
I cannot tell you.
Then what is it?
I cannot tell you. But yon young electrician, Mr. Blackmore, he rung down at night, deputy. It seems as if there's been a fall or something.
Lizzie, you parted from him in anger. There's no knowing how you'd meet him again.
Well, happen I'd best be going to see what's betide.
I'm sure I've had my share of bad luck, I have. I'm sure I brought five lads up in the pit through accident and troubles, and now there's this. The Lord's been very hard on me. Very hard. It's a blessing, Lizzie, that you've got a bit of money, else what had become of the children?
Well, if he is badly hurt, there'll be the union pay and sick pay. We shall manage. And perhaps it's not very much.
There's no knowing that they're carrying him to die in the hospital.
Oh, don't say so, Mother. It won't be so bad, you'll see. Hush.
What is it, Lizzie? What?
That's twice they've sent the chair down.
What? Oh, I wish we could see.
What is it, Lizzie?
Yes. It stopped at the gate. It's the doctor's.
What, Lizzie?
The doctor's motor. Do you stop here, Mother, while I run up to top and see?
Oh, you'd better not go, Lizzie. You'd better not. A woman's best away.
It is unbearable to wait.
Come in and shut the door. It's a cold that gets into your bones.
Perhaps while he's in bed, we shall have time to change him. It's an ill wind brings no good. He'll happen be a better man.
Well, you can but try. Many a woman's thought the same.
Oh, dear, I wish somebody would come. He's never been hurt since we were married.
No, he's never had a bad accident. All the years he's been in the pit, he's been luckier than most. But everyone has it, sooner or later.
It is a horrid night. Hark!
They're bringing him now, Mrs.
Oh.
There must have been a fall directly after we left him.
No.
It fell back on him and shut him in as you might shut a loaf in the oven. Never touched him.
Well, then?
You see, it come on him as close as a trap on a mouse and get him no air. What with gas, it smothered him. Wouldn't have been so very long about it, neither.
Oh.
Dear. I wasn't it to know what had happened.
Lord, give him time to repent. He'd have a few minutes to repent. I hope he did, else what's to become of him? The Lord cut him off in his sins, but he gave him a little time to repent. Have you got the things ready, Lizzie?
What things?
To lay the child out.
No. What?
Haven't you put him by a pair of white stockings and a white shirt?
He's got a white cricketing shirt, but not white stockings.
Oh, I'll have to fetch his father's. Let me look at that shirt, Lizzie. This'll never do, a cold canvas thing with a turned down collar. He'll have to have his father's. You don't want no other woman to touch him, do you? To wash him, lay him out?
No.
Well, fetch him his father's gear. Bless him. Won't be more than a minute or two. We'll watch him when I get back, Lizzie.
All right. My dear, oh, my dear, I can't bear it. My dear, you shouldn't have done it. You shouldn't have done it. Oh.
bear it for you? Why couldn't I do anything for you? The children's father. My dear, I wasn't good to you, but you shouldn't have done this to me. Oh, dear, oh, dear. Did it hurt you? Oh, my dear. It hurt you. Oh, I can't bear it. No. No. Things aren't fair. We went wrong, my dear. I never loved you enough. I never did. What a shame for you. It was a shame, but you didn't... You didn't try. I would have loved you. I tried hard. It was so cruel for you. You couldn't help it. My dear. You couldn't help it. And I can't do anything for you. And it hurt you so. My dear. My dear. What can I do for you? What can I do?
The language of a play, as Lawrence knew, is written language for actors to speak. This is a special use of language which can be read on its own, but was intended to be enriched by the physical presence of the actors, by the physical gestures, the production of a room, to the point even where the writer can seem to be absent, and we're listening, we might think, to actual men and women in an actual house at this moment of crisis. At the same time, Lawrence chose a particular form of play centered in one room and limited to what he thought his people would probably say at such a time. This has two main effects. In the story, the narrative voice can go beyond the room to the whole place in which people are pressed, trapped, at the extreme even killed by the weight and noise of this kind of work. It's a general as well as a particular situation. But to speak of the general situation may require a voice which is not that of any of the suffering people, but a voice with more range, bringing in the work, the country, in a wider look at what finally happens in that trapped, grieving room. The second difference is even more important. When the woman looks in the play at her dead husband, Lawrence writes her grief and confusion in disjointed, broken phrases, what he thinks she might probably be able to say at such a time. This is moving, but unfinished. What went wrong? In the story, it is at this point that a quite different use of language comes through, not just narrative and description, but an attempt to write a whole experience in words not limited to what might actually or probably get said. The grandmother says, "He had the heartiest laugh, Lizzie, as a lad." Elizabeth looked up. It's from this moment that the language shifts. As we listen to it, we notice first how much more she is feeling than can be put into words in ordinary speech. Describing her whole experience, there's another language. Her soul died in her for fear, and also her mind, cold and detached, said clearly. At this point of crisis, there's also another question we must ask. Lawrence wrote both versions. In the play, He gives the actress the broken words of grief and self-questioning. In the story, he goes beyond this, but to what? To what she's really feeling? Perhaps, but perhaps also to what Lawrence wants to tell us through this woman about failures of relationship. Then who is speaking? Character or author? That's the hardest question raised by these different uses of language in play and in the story.
When Elizabeth came down, she found the mother alone on the parlor floor, leaning over the dead man, the tears dropping on him. "We must lay him out," the wife said. The room was clammy, dim, with only one candle. Together, they stripped the man. Elizabeth embraced her husband with cheek and lips. She seemed to be listening, inquiring, trying to get some connection. But she could not. She was driven away. He was impregnable. She rose, went into the kitchen, where she poured warm water into a bowl, brought soap and flannel and a soft towel. "I must wash him," she said. She was afraid with a bottomless fear, so she ministered to him. The old woman, jealous, said, "Let me wipe him." And she kneeled on the other side, drying slowly as Elizabeth washed. They worked thus in silence for a long time. At last it was finished. He was a man of handsome body, and his face showed no traces of drink. He was blonde, full-fleshed with fine limbs, but he was dead. "Bless him," whispered his mother, looking always at his face and speaking out of sheer terror. "Dear lad, bless him." She spoke in a faint, sibilant ecstasy of fear and mother love. Elizabeth sank down again to the floor and put her face against his neck and trembled and shuddered. But she had to draw away again. He was dead. And her living flesh had no place against his. A great dread and weariness held her. She was so unavailing. Her life was gone like this. White as milk he is, and clear as a 12-month baby, bless him, the darling. The old mother murmured to herself. Not a mark on him. Clear and clean and white. Beautiful as ever a child was made. She murmured with pride. Elizabeth kept her face hidden. "They went peaceful, Lizzie. Peaceful asleep. Ain't he beautiful, bless him? Aye, but he must have made his peace, Lizzie. Happen he made it all right, Lizzie. Shut in here, he'd have time. He wouldn't look like this if he hadn't made his peace. The lamb, the dear lamb. But he had the artist laugh. I love to hear it. He had the artist laugh, Lizzie, as a lad." Elizabeth looked up. The man's mouth was fallen back, slightly open under the cover of the moustache. The eyes half shut, did not show glazed in the obscurity. Life, with its smoky burning gone from him, had left him apart and utterly alien to her. And she knew what a stranger he was to her. In her womb was ice of fear, because of this separate stranger with whom she had been living as one flesh. Was this what it all meant? Utter, intact separateness? Obscured by heat of living? In dread, she turned her face away. The fact was too deadly. There had been nothing between them, and yet they had come together, exchanging their nakedness repeatedly. Each time he had taken her, they had been two isolated beings, far apart as now. He was no more responsible than she. The child was like ice in her womb. For, as she looked at the dead man, her mind, cold and detached, said clearly, "Who am I? What have I been doing? I have been fighting a husband who did not exist. He existed all the time. What wrong have I done? What was that I have been living with? There lies the reality, this man." And her soul died in her for fear. She knew she had never seen him. He had never seen her. They had met in the dark and fought in the dark, not knowing whom they met nor whom they fought. And now she saw and turned silent in seeing. And all the while her heart was bursting with grief and pity for him. What had he suffered? What stretch of horror for this helpless man? She was rigid with agony. She had not been able to help him. He had been cruelly injured, this naked man, this other being, and she could make no reparation. She saw this episode of her life closed. They had denied each other in life. Now he had withdrawn. An anguish came over her. It was finished then.